are really us-centered. Because that's, we're the ones who are asking the question. And we're the ones that are making the story. So we're all, every culture is making this observation about how we got here from their own perspective, from their own philosophical sense, from their own capacity to explore the universe. And so, what's our modern day creation story? Well, usually it's like the Big Bang, right? That's where it all began. And how do we account for human beings? Begins with the E. Evolution. Yeah. And so that's our story. It comes from a very scientific perspective. Why? Because we are people who are driven by science and technology. This is the kind of thing that we understand. Now, every creation story, in some ways, has some kind of defect. It's lacking something because none of us, creation is such a vast and seemingly an infinite exploration that we're going to miss something. Well, the scientific perspective is great on what and how things came to be, but is almost entirely absent why and who. And so we have to, that's why the church is not against the Big Bang Theory. The church is not against evolution. But we're able to go further and get into the why, the who, and the purpose of creation. So in many ways, of course he was a Catholic priest that came to the calculations that led to the Big Bang Theory. He was a Belgian priest and a friend of Albert Einstein. So, all I want to say by this is that we're going to look at the story of origin, of course, from the perspective of our faith. And what is God trying to communicate to us about who created, and why, and what is our purpose? So these are the kind of questions that creation stories explain. Why is there something rather than nothing? How did life come about? Well, this duck went down to the bottom of the lake and picked up some dirt, and they made people out of it. So it's also, trying to understand, what are we like? And why are we like the way that we are? Most creation stories, if you go deeper into them, they try to explain, so why are we so angry? Why do we have fights? Why are we envious? It's a deeper dive into creation stories. And, of course, the questions of what is our purpose? One other thing I just want to mention when it talks about stories of origin or creation stories, there are several different versions of creation, of the creation story. Throughout the Bible, in the book of Proverbs, in chapter 8 of Proverbs, there's a whole description how wisdom, and usually we refer to wisdom as Lady Wisdom, how Lady Wisdom was at God's side creating the earth. It's a different story. The story, in the end of the story of Job, God recounts. He says, were you there when I created the tiger? Were you there when I created the sea monsters? Even Psalm 104. It's a poetic version of the creation story. So when we think about this, there are different perspectives. And so sometimes when I do talk about creation, they say, was it really 7 days? And that's not a foolish question. But, that's the kind of thing you can get into. So anyways, there's a variety of... when I say this too, this should help us when we read the Bible Sometimes we get afraid of reading the Bible because it's confusing. But if you stick with it for a long time, you start to understand this, and wow, the Holy Spirit is inspiring these authors to present different perspectives that fill out more of our understanding, as opposed to saying, this is how it happened, and that's it. No, there's a lot of flexibility in our understanding. We grow. The Bible is meant to stretch us, to lead us to new insights. And so, you know, especially in a creation story like this, you need to use your imagination. You need to think, well, what does that suggest? You know, how is this different? But we'll get a little more of that in a little bit. So, let's start with the in the beginning. Yeah, that's a good place to start. I can't do the Sound of Music version of that, but I can't sing it. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was over the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. So, what does darkness and the deep, of course the deep means the sea, what does that suggest when you put together darkness and a wild ocean? What does that suggest to you? This is what God is facing. He's dealing with this. Any thoughts?
Chaos.
Thank you very much. That's what God is facing, is chaos. And when the Bible talks about chaos, they mean something that's unformed, disordered, scattered, desolate, you know, uninhabitable. Those are the things that God is facing in this particular story. You know? And so so how does this profile God right now? He's got to get to work, right? He's got to bring some order into this, because this is a mess. You know, and all of you that have kids, you know what chaos is like, right? Somebody needs to, but this is part of the thing. It says, the Spirit of God was hovering over the deep, over the face of the waters. And the connotation in Hebrew, that word hovering, it's a mother bird hovering over her chicks. That's what the verb suggests. That's God, the parent, trying to bring order out of this chaos. And that's not uncommon in various different creation stories. That what you're meant, you're starting with chaos. Now, there are other places in the Bible that make it very clear that God spoke creation out of nothing. That's not at stake here. That truth of the faith is not at stake. But for the sake of understanding the nature of God in the midst of creation, this is how the Bible projects it for us. So, this is what God's facing. So how is he going to deal with the darkness and the wildness of the ocean? The way he's going to do this, first of all, he says, and God said, let there be light. And there was light. And God saw that the light was good. And God separated the light from the darkness. And God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. I put this slide up because what we're going to find over the next several days, I'm not going to talk that long. There's a pattern. God confronts some aspect of the creation. and he speaks light into being. He'll speak five more times. And it's important that we see what God does, he is spoken. He speaks and it comes to be. Because that's the second thing. God said, let there be light, and there was light. So the importance, one of the important parts to take away from this is, what does a word do for us? What does speaking do for us? It informs, right? It says what I'm telling you is intelligible. And this is what God is doing. By speaking, instead of fashioning, by speaking things into being, it means that they're intelligible. That they proceed from an intelligence, from a being who is rational. That this isn't the work, the random work of the gods. Like, have you ever read about the Greek gods? A lot of it was just accidental. You know, they just run into something and say, oh, well, there it is. Now it's a mountain. This was all intentional and intelligible. And that's why science can understand it. You know? If not for God's intelligence, we wouldn't understand what he has created. So this is, and I was saying this yesterday to folks, you know, as we go through this, we're going to say, yes, it wasn't one day. You know, it could have been eons of time. But what you start to see as you understand this progression of creation, it's pretty scientific. It follows an order that's important. Like, where does the energy of our Earth come from? Ultimately, it's the sun. It's light. Light is the beginning. E equals mc squared, right? You know, the energy and the speed of light are, you know, melded together. Then God starts with light. You know, I think Albert Einstein was really happy with that. It explains a lot. So, you know, when we're talking about this, isn't just necessarily religious, but there's some strong science involved with this. You know, we should never denigrate. You know, people will start saying, well, this is just a story made up by these Christians or these Jews. Well, you know, if God revealed it, you know, there might be something to this, you know? And so we should never be ashamed or feel like, you know, that's one of the things we have a hard time today convincing our young people. That science is not the answer. I mean, it's got some good answers, but it's not the answer. But the why and the who is much more important. But you can't denigrate the science that's just right here in Genesis chapter 1, written thousands of years ago. So, and then God, after he sees the result, he says, God saw that it was good. And this is important just for one particular reason, a lot of reasons. First of all, it's good. Light is good. The second thing is, it frames God as having a perspective on his creation. That it's not pantheism, that God is somehow mixed up in his creation. There's a kind of separation, or at least a distance between God and his creation. He's able to step back. See how what his work is like. And fortunately, he finds all these days very good, which is a good thing. So he has the possibility to stand back and appreciate his work. Then God, the next thing is he names. He called the light day, and the darkness he called the night. The whole, as we're going to see, especially in chapter 2, the whole naming thing is important because it shows that God, again, is intentional, but that he's in control. He names. If he doesn't call it light, then we don't know what we're going to call it. So, he is demonstrating not just his power, but his goodness in this. And then the morning comes and evening follows the first day. So we're going to see this progression. And we'll just have to get used to it as we go along. So what we'll find is there are 6 days. We're already starting to begin with the division of the night and the day. And what you'll see here is the first 3 days are this. The main word here is division. So he distinguishes the night and the day, the sky and the sea, the water and the dry land. And so what is God doing? He's creating space. First, the space of time. And then the space between the sky and the sea. And then the space of the dry land. In the next 3 days, day 4, 5, and 6, we're going to have the inhabitants of these various spaces. So we're going to see that in day 4, the sun, moon, and the stars inhabit the night and the day. In day 5, the birds and the fish are created. So as they inhabit the sky and the sea. And in day 6, the space for the animals and us, thank God. So this process of division and this it's God is very intentional. First, he's creating the conditions. We need light and we need darkness. We need the sky. We'll talk, get into that, and then we need the dry land. And he's creating the opportunity for us to inhabit the various spaces of creation. Does that make sense? Any questions so far? Anybody has? Because I will ask for questions. If you have something that's burning in your mind, maybe just write it down and then ask what I ask you again if there's any questions. Okay? All right, so let's move on. When are you guys used to finishing? 7:30 or so? 7:04? So, day three. God separates. Let the waters of the heavens be gathered together in one place, and let the dry land appear. And it was so. And God called the dry land earth. Or land. Which, you know, the same thing. But in this case, the particular connotation of the land is the land of Israel. And how did Israel come into the land? Well, they came into it by inheritance. So when it identifies the dry land, it's implying this is the inheritance of the human race. The human race hasn't been made yet. But already God's preparing this place, this inheritance, that he's going to confer unto the whole human race. The land. The land is the source of our life. And as we'll find out, especially in chapter 2, the land is the source of us, the clay. So this is all very methodical, very organized. It's in strong contrast with all the ancient Middle Eastern stories, which were about wars between gods and creating human beings out of the blood and the carcass of a dragon. It's very violent, but in God's creation, in the Jewish understanding, very methodical, very peaceful, very deliberate. So God continues, let the earth sprout vegetation, plants yielding seed, and fruit trees bearing fruit, in which is their seed, each according to its kind on the earth. And it was so. And God saw that it was good. This is the first time God does not name something. Again, the earth is already created, and what he's doing there is he's populating the earth with fruitfulness, with the capacity to bear life. This is the kind of thing we're doing space exploration right now in the world, trying to find if we can live on Mars. So what's the first thing we're going to need to do? We're going to need to make Mars inhabitable. So the scientists are working this out. God did this just by speaking. That's pretty cool. So we'll move on now to the fourth day. He says, let there be lights in the canopy of the heavens to separate the day from the night. Let them be for signs and seasons, for days and years. And let them be lights in the canopy of the heavens to give light upon the earth. And it was so. And God made the two great lights, the greater light to rule the day, and the lesser light to rule the night, and then the stars. This word to rule is often spoken of by about kings. Kings rule. They have dominion. They have responsibility. They bring things into order. And so the sun, the moon, and the stars are to order the day and the night. Again, we don't need to be scientists to know that. We know what the tides are like. We know that you have to pay attention to them, that they are actually ruling our lives. The night and the day, the sun goes down, we're in darkness, and the moon comes forth. It doesn't come forth that far often in Michigan because it's very, very cloudy often, but you know it's there. So again, this kind of deliberation and concern for order is something that just shot through God's creation. Okay, so now we're going to move on to the fifth day. The creatures of the sea and the sky. I like the sea turtle. The loon is my favorite bird, just so you know. Yes, ma'am. The planets? The moon, the stars, the sea, yeah. So they hadn't figured out planets yet at the time that they were writing this. Seriously, you know, that. Yeah, the moon and the sun are obvious. Yeah, and all the stars. So they're just part of all the stars. No problem. So you ask about what happened to the planets. They're there. They're stars. At that point, they're stars. Okay? We're good. Good. No, that's a good question. We got into the kinds of things. I appreciate your thinking about that. Because that's the kind of thing we need to do with the Bible. We need to question it sometime. Try to figure it out. We're not fundamentalists. We don't just say, well, this is the only thing it can be. No, there's a lot of leeway. Now, if you go against the creed, you're done. Obviously, we can't just make stuff up. But there's a lot of room for us to use our imagination in order to understand the scripture. And sometimes we might have really good insights. Yeah. Yes, sir. Did God create many worlds? I assume it's possible. Yeah, you know, it's you know, what people look at is say that's the stars, or it's a whole other galaxy, right? So there is a Jesuit priest who is a Catholic as well. Who's the Vatican? He runs the Vatican Observatory, and he's opined on that himself, which is to say, you know, is because the was it? It's I had to give a little talk on this, but it's like 14 billion light years wide. That's how wide, and light year is like a gazillion miles, and so the expanse of the universe continuing to expand. Yeah, so. There's no indication in Scripture about it, but it doesn't mean that there isn't something. So the question is, are there other worlds? Maybe? We don't know. I mean, when you look at the distances, if we tried to get there to the other world, wow, it would take a long, long time. So, okay, so any other questions or... comments? Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, one word is there. And what are they saying now that they see inhabitants in Mars?
I'm sorry.
Inhabitants. Like in Mars?
Oh, are there other inhabitants? Yeah. So, I mean, that's what they're trying to do right now, right? They're trying to. So, are there other inhabitants of other worlds? Could be. We don't know. So. Okay, can we go on, you think?
Yes.
All right, good. So, God said, let the waters swarm with the swarms of living creatures, and let birds fly above the earth across the canopy of the heavens. So God created the great sea creatures and every living creature that moves, and every winged bird. So again, this is kind of a quick and easy one. He's just inhabiting the seas and the sky. And so on the sixth day, we're focus on first on part one. This is verse 24. And God said, let the earth bring forth living creatures according to their kinds, livestock, creeping things, the beasts of the earth according to their kinds. And it was so. And so God created all these different things. And I like Gary Larson. I don't know if you're really at the far side. So if you can't read this here, it says, so this is obviously God, and he's got a bunch of clay, green clay, and so he's making a snake. And God says, boy, these things are a cinch. We just need a little humor there. And it's very little humor, I understand, but it's going to be a little humor. But we need to get to the important part, and this will hopefully... may prompt some other questions. Then God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the heavens, and over the livestock, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God he created him. Male and female he created them. So what questions does this raise? Us. Who's us? Yeah, that came up last night, same thing. Who's us? So what do you think? This is one of those places that we have to use our imagination because we don't know who us is. So what are some proposals? Yes, ma'am. You got an idea? You know, I can't hear anything you said, so you might want to shout it out, Toby.
God and the angels?
The angels. Very good. Any other thoughts?
Jesus Christ.
Could be the Trinity? Yeah? Yeah, so Jesus and the Holy Spirit, yeah. Okay. Good, I mean, those are possibilities. But one of the things that, you know, that we're going to see in various places in the scripture is that God has a council, not a parish council, but he's got a council. Because why? He's a king. And so one of the things we have to get used to, especially in trying to understand the Old Testament, but all through the scripture, is the Bible really does not conceive God as anything else but a king. And now for us, you know, that have kind of the Western, you know, Republican, not the party, but the ideal of monarchy, we reject monarchy and we have a difficult time with kings and queens and all that, but God doesn't seem to have a problem with us calling him the king. And so right from the very beginning, what the scripture is doing is settling the fact. We're dealing with the monarch, the one who rules not just Israel, but the one who made heaven and earth, and therefore has the right to rule the earth, the heavens, and the earth. And so part of this is, and so in the Jewish conception of kingship, and if you follow some of the kings like David or King Saul, they always have a retinue around them. They have their officers, their magistrates, their judges. They're all together in the king's room, or they're available to the king at all times to do his bidding. And so that's probably who the us is, you know, the conception of, and in this case, God's messengers, his ministers, are the angels. So that, I mean, it's a good prospect. It would be difficult for the, I mean, it would have to be an extraordinary inspiration if the human author understood us as the Trinity. That mystery is only becomes viable, really, until Christ. Without Christ's revelation, we wouldn't know the Father. We wouldn't know the Holy Spirit. But, nonetheless, God is a king. So we say, let's make man in our image and after our likeness. So if you turn to chapter 5, verse 3. When Adam had lived 130 years, he fathered a son in his own likeness, after his image, and named him Seth. Does that sound familiar? It sounds a lot like what we just read, Genesis 1:27. That's important for us to catch. Because you notice, even in the wording, of Genesis 1:27. He says, he's very deliberate. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. Now, if you have a revised edition of the New American Bible, you might see it translated as, in the image of God, he created them, male and female, he created them. But the word in Hebrew is him. And he means all of us. So what does it imply about us? So if Adam gave birth to a son who is after the image and in the likeness of his father, what does that say about us, corporately, the human race? We're God's son. This whole idea of the body of Christ has not even been remotely thought of, because Christ had not been revealed. But that's what God created all of us to be his son. And for what purpose? And God blessed them. And God said, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth and subdue it. And have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the heavens, and over every living thing that moves on the earth. We have a purpose as God's son. First of all, to be fruitful. Why? Because God wants the spaces that he has created, he wants them inhabited. He doesn't want them, because if they're not inhabited, if they're not in the garden, it's going to turn back to chaos. He needs us to be present to the fish of the sea, to the creeping things of the earth, to the beasts of the field, because they need us to have dominion over them. When I say dominion, I don't mean domination, but to have dominion. Let me just, for example, in 1 Kings 4:24, it says of Solomon, for Solomon had dominion over all the region west of the Euphrates, and he had peace on all sides around him. Solomon was the second greatest king of Israel, David being the first. So by the exercise of his kingship, what did Solomon bring about? Peace. In this case, shalom in Hebrew. If you ever study Hebrew, you'll find out that a lot of Hebrew words are like rubber bags. That is to say, you can keep stuffing meaning into that word. So when you say shalom, it just doesn't mean, okay, we're done fighting. No, it means harmony. It means prosperity. It means goodwill. It means laughter. It means joy. It means a whole bunch of things. They're all good things. Kind of like the epitome of basically of what life was like in the garden. That's what they're trying. That's what we're all seeking for. So our role as a human race, and we'll see that reinforced again in chapter 2, is to have dominion that establishes peace throughout the whole earth. So, if you were to give us a performance evaluation, how do you think we're doing? We got work to do, don't we? Yeah, we really do. But again, this is God's purpose. This is why he created you and me. And it's, we still got work to do. So, it says, and God saw everything he had made, and behold, it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the sixth day. Thus, this is now we're into chapter 2. Thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and all the host of them. And on the seventh day God finished his work that he had done, and he rested on the seventh day from all his work that he had done. So God blessed the seventh day and made it holy, because on it God rested from all his work that he had done in creation. This is where we get the Sabbath. God made the seventh day, which in the Hebrew calendar was Saturday, to be the Sabbath. And the reason, at least in the book of Exodus, is because God rested on the seventh day. So, why was God able to rest on the seventh day? He's been pretty busy for the last 6 days, definitely. You know, creating a universe is not something you just do at the toss, you know. For him, I maybe wasn't so difficult, because he just said, you know, speak and let it be done, you know. Is it like Ten Commandments, let it be written, let it be done kind of thing? Yeah, that, he didn't even have to get right. So, but it says God rested. So what were the conditions that made God able to rest on the Sabbath day? His son was at work on the seventh day. What he's saying is like, yeah, I can rest because you guys got it. That was his intention. God rests because he knows his son is there. We're meant to be, you know, so what did Jesus do before he became the rabbi? He was a carpenter. Why? His dad was a carpenter. His son does what his father does. That's why God created us in his image and likeness, because he wanted somebody to do what he does. And he chose us to do that, the whole human race. And of course, you know, in chapter 2 we find out why we're really not doing so well at this. But that's the purpose. That's what we were created for. God isn't some dictator who, you know, assassinates everybody that threatens his dominion. He's very comfortable. He's ready. He's fine. Say, I'm taking a break. You know, I'm going to flip on and see, you know, how the Lions are doing. Of course, he knows all the time that they're going to lose. But, no, I mean, I don't mean to be frank, but this is the relationship that he's trying to instill into us. So, I'll let you do a little, we can do some more questions and answers if you want, but I just offer some things for reflection. First of all, I just want to mention, creation is oriented to worship. We're going to see about that more in another way next Tuesday. But it's important that we understand. You know, if you're paying attention to our creation, you can't help but say there's something ultimate. There's something beyond. There's something greater than I. And that's essential for worship. That fundamental humility that says, I didn't make all this. You know, I didn't make the glory, you know, just being here. You know, I didn't make these sunsets. I can only acknowledge that somebody put on a show for me today. You know, beyond, you know, nobody can imitate what God creates. And then there's something that's just inherent to the human psyche that, you know, where do you go to a mountain, top of a mountain, just to see how grand everything is. Those all are elements of worship. Maybe they're not maybe they're pagan worship, maybe they're secular worship, but there is something about creation that, that demands that we acknowledge something much vaster, much more beautiful, much more powerful than we. And then, just to remind ourselves, the forces of chaos are still at work in the world today. And I don't mean get smart. Some of you are old enough to remember get smart, some of you aren't, which is a poverty for you. But so the question, you know, it brings that question, in a very broad sense, how do we deal with the chaos? How do we invoke the Holy Spirit to hover over the chaos even in our own lives? One of my spiritual directors was very strong on that. He would often say to us, yes, things are out of whack. You're distraught, you're disturbed, you're under distress. But remember, the Spirit of God is hovering over even that small chaos. And that's what I want to offer. So let's do some questions and comments. So,
you said that the Holy Spirit was a revelation of Christ.
Yes.
Wasn't the Holy Spirit in Exodus when Moses was burning the plagues? Is that like, was it a different Holy Spirit? Or?
No, it wasn't a different Holy Spirit. It was the Holy Spirit. It just wasn't named at that point. Yeah, so the question is there a different Holy Spirit? Because, you know, the Spirit of God was moving in Moses. And so, so that's a good question. But the revelation of the Trinity really doesn't come about until the Son is incarnated. And he's the one who reveals the Holy Spirit as also God. You know, the Spirit of God could be some other kind of spirit. It could be, often he says, he calls his messengers spirits. And so, in some ways, just more of a linguistic thing. So, great question. Other questions or comments? Yes. Okay, so for most of you guys in your Bibles, verse 27 is kind of indented on both sides. And that's usually an indication that it's poetry. And so even in, it's sometimes that's people's definition. Yeah, he's making poetry. He's making poetry right at that moment. That's what the text usually turns to. Because sometimes that's just the definition of poetry, right? What is poetry? Anything that doesn't go to the end of the line. Right? Something that's indented somewhere. You know, okay, that's got to be poetry. Huh? Doesn't sound like poetry. It doesn't rhyme. How can that be poetry? Yes, please. We still have chaos today. That's chapter 2. Actually, chapter 3. Yeah. So we'll get to that. Yeah. Yes, ma'am. So the question was, why do we still have chaos? Well, it's because of us. You know. So, anyways, yes, ma'am. Sabbath's made the question, yes, what Jesus says about the Sabbath. The Sabbath is made for man, not man for the Sabbath. But all that is to say, but why do we have the Sabbath? Because it's holy. So something that's holy is something that belongs to God. And so God claims this space of time on Saturday. I mean, it wasn't Saturday then, it was the Sabbath day then, but we take the seventh day. And God makes it holy. That means he's saying it all belongs to God. And so what do you do on the Sabbath day? You do what God does. God rests. And that makes sense for us too, because we don't observe the Sabbath per se. We observe the Lord's Day, Sunday. And so what do we do on Sunday? What did God do on Sunday? Okay, yeah. He rose from the dead. So what do? We join him in his resurrection from the dead in the Eucharist. So that makes sense. You know, some people we have trouble at times, you know, we think we're supposed to be like Jewish people, but we don't do anything on Sunday. But that's a different story, a different question. We had some other questions, we'll get back to you. Some other hands were up? Yes. Is the inspired offer describing a vision? What the church is teaching on inspiration. I got the worst of that, believe me. So, what the instruction on divine inspiration will say is that the author used his own interpretation, his own thoughts, his own feelings, his own determinations, but the Spirit somehow inspired him. He acted as a true author, in other words. He did his research, he did his imagination, he did his outlines, and yet the Holy Spirit inspired him to write only what the Spirit wanted him to write. So putting together, it's an incarnational process. It's not like, automatic writing. It's not like, you know, some of the medieval and Renaissance portraits of St. Matthew writing the gospel, and there's this cherub standing next to him, you know, kind of pointing out, well, first there's this, and then there's that, and then there's this other thing. That's not the way it worked. But he acted as a true author, and the Holy Spirit used him through that process. Does that help?
Yeah.
Oh,
so you said earlier that, you know, ways are all children of God, Son of God. So in the whole Trinity, is it strictly that Jesus is talking about himself as the Son of God, or is it also learned that we're all, that God works, you know, does good works through his people? So is it like a larger metaphor, if you will? Not
sure.
Just
right. So the question is Jesus the only Son of God, or is it something larger, like a larger collective? That's where we have the teaching in the Scripture, the body of Christ. So we as a human race are joined to the head. Christ is the head, and we are the body. And so we are the full Christ. Especially if you read St. Augustine, he's very, very strong on this. He makes this much clearer than I can. But St. Augustine is very strong in the body of Christ as being the reality of what the church is. That, you know, or St. Teresa of Avila, she'll say, Christ has no hands but your hands. Christ has no feet but your feet. Christ has no eyes but your eyes. Because we're the body of Christ. But thanks. Yes, ma'am. Okay, so I was making this. Thank you for the question. The question is, what did God do on the Lord's Day? He said he raised Jesus from the dead, not he rested. So God does something different on the Lord's Day than he did on the Sabbath day. Any other questions, thoughts? Very good. I think we've had our useful time, and I hope that was useful to you. So let's just give a blessing and remain seated, and we can get ready for next week. So, Almighty God, we thank you for the light you shed upon us this day. We ask your continued grace and understanding, that we might rejoice in your word and your truth. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
All right, see you next week.